Hi, my name's Ben Thompson. My role is Chief Architect for the Product App Connect Enterprise, which we'll be discussing all about today. I've worked with that software for, gosh, far too long than it's healthy to remember. So around about the year 2000, I started on the product, had some time in software services, and I'm now back in the Hursley lab where I help the guys with some architectural problems that we face. So over to David.
Hey, I'm David Coles. I'm one of the architects for App Connect Enterprise. I've been a developer now for probably 5 or 6 years, but before that I spent 10 plus years in level 3 support. So, you know, I'm pretty knowledgeable in the product these days, having worked on it for 18 years now. Yes, getting a long time now. Sanjay.
I'm Sanjay Nagchaudhary. I'm the team lead in IBM App Connect Enterprise. I've been in the lab for 30 years now. I've been in development with App Connect Enterprise for about 15 years. And been working in lots of different areas.
But just to get us kicked off, we're going to be talking about a lot of different topics today. IBM Integration Bus, to use the old name of the product, App Connect Enterprise, to use the newer name. And we've had our last three major releases of the software, where we sometimes describe it as doing open heart surgery on the product. And that's really the main opportunity we get for that kind of thing every 2 or 3 years. So if we wind the clock back to 2015, we had the release of version 10 of our product, and that had some big problems with it where containers are concerned. So we had to run some local commands against it. It wasn't very declarative in the way that it operated. So what we thought we'd do to get ourselves kicked off is talk about some highlights in V11 and V12, which were the two major releases. So if we start with David, can you say a bit about what V11 did for us?
Yeah, so V11, you know, as Ben said, one of the problems we were having in 2015 was containers were starting to take over the world, certainly becoming very popular, you know, spin up a single executable that actually process data and stuff. Now, what we found with that IBM integration bus at the time is that you had multiple processes. So you run MKSI start, you create an integration node, it fired up a data flow engine, a bit broker, a bit service, lots of different processes, lots of talking between. And it was really hard to monitor failure. So the idea with containers is where you run a single process. And so, you know, we had to kind of step back and look at, can we re-architect our product to be a single process that actually runs the integrations? The other thing at the time is to do deploys, to get message flows, to get applications, to get resources actually into this thing that we ran called the data flow engine process, the integration server at the time. You had to do deploys, and that deploy looked at all the data, it picked it up, it threw it around, it changed it, it threw bits away, it kept stuff, you know, did all sorts of stuff, and eventually put it on disk in a incomprehensible format that was really hard to read.
It was a real sort of change in mindset when we think about how containers are ephemeral rather than having the solid storage. It's always behind the running process on the premise.
Yeah, completely. And so what we had to become is more declarative. So we had to, you know, say, okay, I've got these message flow, put this message flow on disk. Here's my integration server, read that message flow, run it. None of this whole deploy chain stuff where we munch stuff, take stuff, deleted stuff, edited stuff, things like that. So we did a massive re-architect of the product so that we could run our independent integration servers. There's this one process that the container could run, and instead of having to do deploys to this process, you could just do a build pipeline, Jenkins, something like that. You can take all these message flows out of these applications, put them on disk, say start up, run this, away we go. All good.
So I think that unzip and go style was really important to make ourselves seem like a very natural citizen in the container world. So if we wind the clock forward, that was sort of circa 2018. We then get to 2021, and when we had our next major release, version 12. So Sanjay, do you want to talk a little bit about that release?
Sure. So in version 12, we rebranded the toolkit extensively. The message flow editor now has a new palette whereby we have toolbox nodes and connector nodes. The toolbox nodes have a color background and the connector nodes have white background. For example, the connector nodes might be HTTP based or MQ based, for example. We also did a lot of work so that customers could unit test their flows easily. So you could write unit tests to check the individual nodes in your flows. You'd use things called stubs and spies on your nodes to check that they're working as they should be. And you could run these unit tests in your pipeline so that you could get an early indication of any failures. Another area that we did was in the being able to connect to SaaS connectors. So we have this new capability where you can use discovery connectors. So you can now use SaaS connectors like Slack, Amazon S3, and you can now use different actions like create, update, delete, and access those SaaS endpoints through different accounts that you have.
So that was a great intro of the different pieces. I think what we might do in the conversation today is kind of delve into a few of those different areas that we just touched on and go into a bit more detail around it. So it's interesting with you mentioning the designer connectors there. There were several pieces of that technology that we had that we really developed for our public cloud offering that we needed to change around to make it work successfully in our on-premises offering as well, in part of our software offering. And one of those primary pieces was, of course, our Vault technology. So maybe if we go to David, you could say a little bit about what the Vault is and the sorts of things we had to solve problems for in order to make the thing work.
Yeah. So back in prior to version 11, people would create identities and give configuration, username, passwords and things to connect to different endpoints. And they would do that using a command called mksisetdbpalms.
The best named command ever.
Best named command ever, because originally it was just setting parameters for connecting to databases. 20 years later, it does so much more than just connecting to databases. It's HTTP, it's SAP, it's all these different endpoints, as well as databases, but it's lots of other things too. So we did a bit of a rebrand and a bit of a re-engineer during version 11 timeframe, I think around FixPack 4, where we brought out the concept of credentials and also Vault. The idea of Vault being that you can say, okay, I've got these passwords and stuff, I want them to be securely encrypted using a well-known AES-256 algorithm, right number of key derivations and things like that. So, the Vault is really a secure store. And around that, we also added this layer of credentials whereby everything is now very strongly typed. So setdbpalms was a bit woolly in terms of, I want to create a database connection and you try and add passphrases and it's easy to misconfigure, whereas Vault is the credentials is very strongly typed. And so you say, okay, right, I've got an ODBC connection, that's username and password. I've got a private end, some other private cloud endpoint that needs a private key. So there's all different typings of these different things to allow you to actually get your configuration quicker and easier and more correct straight away. The other thing there with that is that also gave us extensibility, this credentials layer we put on, and as well as having credentials stored in the Vault, you could also have them provided just in ServerConf YAML. So if you're doing containers, you can just upload a ServerConf YAML file, which is a configuration file with the credentials in, and that just goes in container. That's back to this declarative story we were talking about earlier. And the other thing is you can plug in external providers. So you can write your own external credential provider that uses scripts to go off and talk to other products that may supply credentials.
So
one useful thing we did in the toolkit was that you could launch a test server. So you could start an integration server and try out your flows very quickly. And recently in version 12, we added capability so that you could specify a Vault for your integration server. So you could use the credentials in that Vault which are used by your flows. So that was something that was very useful and that we added in version 12.
It's an interesting point when we think about the basics of the Vault. It was very much about getting the architectural building blocks in place that could then be used for a variety of different use cases ultimately. And I think, just the things you were saying there about the use within the discovery connectors, as we call them, or the designer connectors, the name of the UI, the UX where we originally took them from. In that particular use case, for the first time, we had a need to use the credentials both at build time and runtime. So maybe if we go back to Sanjay, you can tell us a little bit about what's just hot off the press in version 12.09 to allow us to make that discovery process a little bit easier in toolkit using the Vault.
In version 12.09, we now have an external directory Vault, and it means that when you are configuring your flows to connect to your SaaS endpoints using a discovery connector, when you launch the discovery connector wizard, you need to specify an account to connect to that SaaS endpoint, and you need to specify the credentials for that account will be using, so whether it's a user ID, password, API key, and you'd store those credentials in the Vault. Now, previously in 12.08, you'd have to stop and start your integration server. So if your integration server was running and it was using the Vault, you'd have to stop the server and then configure a node with the credentials and then start the server again. You won't need to do that in 12.09 because we have this new external directory Vault, and it means that while the server is running using the external directory Vault, you can still configure your flows in the toolkit and make the connection to the SaaS endpoint, specify the credentials, specify the policy, which references the endpoint URL and the credential that's used in the vault without needing to go back and forth with stopping and starting the server.
So I think we've kind of dived deep there on the vault. It might be good to sort of bring ourselves back up a level and think about some of the other concepts that we mentioned in the intro. And we've already spoken quite a bit about declaratively defining how an integration server should work. And one of those big changes was in the area of what we call policies owned by policy projects. So I think it might be nice if we talk through just the basic concept of how a policy operates and how it overrides and that kind of thing, just to make it clear what policies are, because we've kind of dropped that into the conversation here without much background. So, Dave, yeah. Do you want to start us off on that?
Yeah, so users of IAB V10 and earlier will know a command called mksi create configure service and the concept of configure services.
Another greatly named command.
So, configure services at the time were something you create on the command line. You created it for an integration node that was then shared by all its servers. So, again, you had to run these commands to configure a single node. It's very hard to then extract this configuration and pass it on to other nodes in other areas or deploy it to containers. And what that configure service was, you had perhaps one for JDBC. And on that JDBC one, there'd be properties for like database name, the host and port of the database, what credential or set DB params reference to use, what jars to use for the JDBC database. So all those sort of properties that are related to a single connection to your JDBC database. And there was ones for IMS and KIX and MQ and all sorts of other, every endpoint we connected to basically had a policy. And so what we did, or basically had a configure service even, I'm swapping here into policy because obviously that's been the new name now for the last 7 years. And so what we did in version 11 was took the opportunity to say, okay, right, get rid of all these configure services, they're not declarative, and bring in policies. And obviously policies are a file. And we'll pass over to Sanjay in a minute, who'll talk about how we offer those policy files. And you can take these policy files, and you can actually then deploy them to the runtime.
I think that was the watershed moment. It was also how you take them and move them between environments, really. It becomes an artifact that the user has much closer control over.
Yeah. Right, yeah. So you take them, you can deploy them to the runtime, they can go in source control. They're basically a declarative file. It's like a message flow file, except these are policy files. You can copy them on disk, the server will start up and read them, you can put them in bar files, you can do all sorts of things. But you know, obviously that's how you deploy and run the policy files. How do you offer those policy files?
So since version 11, we've had a policy editor in the toolkit, which allows you to offer the policies. It's a set of key value pairs. It's a straightforward table where you can just specify the values for the different policy attributes. You can also specify user-defined policies as well. So if you need to specify your own policy, then you can add your own attributes in the policy editor as well. Also in version 12, I believe, we added capability whereby if you're deploying a policy that was non-dynamic, then on deploy, it would give you a prompt to say that this will require all of those to restart. And then you'd have that option to say, yes, okay, go ahead, because I want this policy to take effect. And then that would then cause those to restart.
I think that's a really good point. If you think back to version 10 days, David was probably about to say exactly the same
thing.
Probably,
yeah.
It was really confusing for the user when they changed one of these commands.
When
it was a configurable service, whether it's going to take effect or not, right? Is it going to be immediate? Does it need to restart and so on? So yeah.
Yeah, and so that was really, as Ben says, really confusing. You run mksi change properties to change the configurable services. Why was it not changed configurable service?
Lost in the mist of time,
that history. And of course, some of them were dynamic. They would take effect immediately. Some were not. Did anyone really know which ones did which behavior? Nah.